Lakes exist on every continent on Earth, including Antarctica. These lakes are present in different climates and habitats and face a diverse set of threats. By thinking about these systems in a global sense, we can better understand the lakes closer to home. Researchers at the University of Minnesota's Duluth campus are comparing data from Lake Superior with data from East Africa and other parts of the world. They're starting to answer some tough questions about the impacts of climate change on the Great Lakes.
Now, one of the things that's very similar between Superior and these large African lakes is that we are seeing them warm up. Over the past century, Lake Superior has warmed up 2.5 degrees centigrade. But in Lake Tanganyika and in Lake Malawi, we see a similar warming trend in the surface waters of the lake.
What happens when those lakes warm up? These are already the warmest lakes in the world. They're starting to move into new territory, and if some of the climate projections hold, they may warm by 3 to 5 degrees Celsius, that's 6 to 10 degrees Fahrenheit, warmer than they are now.
The surface waters warm more than the deep waters, and so when that happens, you have this very warm light water overlying cooler, denser water. That density stratification gets stronger, and that means that you don't have as much mixing of deep water up and shallow water down.
We're getting less mixing with deep water, and that deep water holds the nutrients that keep the surface waters productive.
That changes the delivery of nutrients to the photic zone, that changes the biology, it cuts back the productivity of the lake.
We're reducing nutrient inputs, we're likely reducing the fish production in those lakes on which millions of people literally depend.
Lake Malawi provides 90% of the protein for the people of Malawi. So these large African lakes are exceedingly important to the people who live around them.
There are no alternatives for those people. So we're immediately beginning to affect the livelihoods and the well-being of millions of people in Africa.
Now these African rift lakes have kilometers of sediment underlying the lake floor, 4 kilometers of sediment. This sediment carries a record of the history of the lake, of the history of the climate around the lake, the history of the ecosystem around the lake. And so shortly after I started working on the African lakes, I started taking sediment cores and analyzing them for evidence of past climate change. And I've done similar work on Lake Superior.
So we can go back and look into lake sediments. And what we see are often very dramatic transitions in microfossil communities that we can only understand and explain by changes in climate.
We're trying to figure out, can we predict when the next major droughts are coming and when the next major floods are coming? Can we do that on, say, a decade by decade scale? We're actually making comparisons between our records from the sediment cores of the East African lakes with the ice cores from Greenland and the ice cores of Antarctica. We're putting together a global pattern of climate variability. We are constantly thinking in terms of the dynamics of Lake Superior in this temperate latitude setting and comparing that with the dynamics of Lake Tanganyika or Lake Victoria in a tropical setting.
But now we have a very open-ended question. What will climate mean to these lakes? And I'm afraid that we don't have ready answers for that. And that's where we're working here, I think, very aggressively to try to provide some of those answers.